be like water, fluid and forgiving. Let me be like water. Let me be like water. Let me be Let me be like water, fluid and forgiving. Let me be like water. Let me be like water. Let me be like water. Let me be like water.
Good morning. Good morning and welcome back. What a powerful week it has been on this campus. Welcome to our streaming audience, St. Paul Nation. Let's give the nation a hand today as well. Welcome. This has been perhaps the most diverse and profound lineup from Ma'afa we have had in 29 years. And we did it. We did it. We do it together. And I'm honored to have with us today, our elder statesman. Dr. Wade Nobles is with us this morning. And we know that God and the ancestors are up to something in this moment. As I've been working with our Fundi, Dr. Itihari Toure, I said, who can do this piece for us? As we begin to really cultivate and deepen our understanding of the African mind, what does that really mean? And she said, let me get back to you. She said, I have somebody in mind, but let me see if it's even possible. I don't want to get your hopes up too high. And she called me back and she said, you ain't going to believe it. Dr. Wade Nobles is willing to come. And so I am delighted to welcome you back to this place, this space, in this moment. And say that we are deeply honored to have you here this morning. And Mama Vera, we are deeply honored to have the both of you here today. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Our master teacher, our Fundi, will come. We're going to do a ritual. I want to explain this in preparation for Sunday morning. We're preparing to acknowledge the work of our menders in becoming. Well, I say in becoming. They say take the N out. Menders becoming. They said, don't put too many words on it, Rev. And you said, what's a mender? Well, before I tell you what a mender is, can I tell you what's broken? Our sense of memory is broken. Our relationships are broken. And even our connection to our children is broken. And so we need some mending. We need some healing. And so a lot of churches have pretty big choirs. Our mending ministry is about as big as a choir. And the reason for that is because when we have lectures and guest speakers, and we unearth much of our trauma, what do you do with it? What do you do with the trauma that you identify? We have learned to create and hold ritual space that we might heal together in community. I want to acknowledge the work of our priest, Mike Elam. Michael Elam, please stand. Dr. Michael Elam, who has been with us how many years? 26 years, who I want to just acknowledge, who has waited on his calling. So many of us rush off without discernment, and we have been able to discern together in community what is his medicine. And his medicine is to partner with the pastor in creating ritual space that we might heal together. I want to honor your journey, your patience, and your trust in this ministry. Thank you. We love you, brother. I love you even when you get on my nerve. That's my brother. That is my brother. One more time, Michael Elam. Thank you so much. So we're still figuring out what all this means. And I was just talking to Dr. Wade Nobles in the back, and he was helping me understand. He said, Pastor, you may not get it yet, but it's happening. The ancestors have been guiding you. None of this is by coincidence, but the ancestors have been guiding you. And I'm excited to have him here today and Mama Vera here today because, well, there's some notions that Western psychology offers that do not suit us as Africans. And he's going to help us understand that, deconstruct that, and give us an understanding of psychology that is more organic and indigenous to who we are as a people. And I'm excited about that. But before that happens, I'm going to ask our Fundi to come as we prepare for the ritual for Sunday. So here's what's going to happen. The menders have been working together for a year of study and apprenticeship. We have traveled to Charleston, South Carolina together. We have been in study together, curated how many hundreds of pages of scholarship? At least 300 to 500 pages of scholarship that we've been reading. And I'll let the menders in on this. You probably shouldn't even know this, but if I'd have told you, it would have scared you. You've actually been studying at a seminary graduate level. Yeah. Crystal just threw her hand up and said, I know that's the truth. I know that's the truth. You, some of you said, I had to read this stuff 6 times, but I got it. And that is the work that's gone into this ritual ministry. And so what we're going to do Sunday is acknowledge the first year of the journey. This is a staff that comes out of my office. It's my personal staff. And what we're going to do is we're going to use this staff for ritual purposes. Each piece of cloth that is here is representative of our menders. And I'm going to ask our Fundi to give some explanation. You were doing so good. I know I was doing well. I know. But I wanted them to hear your voice in this moment. Let us receive Mama Itihari as she comes.
So as Dr. Brawley was saying, is that the fabric of that you see on the table represents the personal ancestors of those who are menders becoming. And what we create is a way of carrying the community's ancestors into the sacred moment. So on Monday, we learned about a libation creating a sacred space, right? And that we're calling on the names of the ancestors that belong to our collective cosmic family. The ancestral staff is created to carry those immediate ancestors into the ritual moment. And so you don't create sacred space without bringing our ancestors in. And so they had an assignment, which is to identify a piece of cloth. In some places, people choose African cloth, but for in some places, I have seen pieces of ties that represent the strength of the masculine energy in their family line. I have seen, for me, kitchen table cloth cut into strip because it was in the kitchen, shucking green beans and preparing vegetables for our family meal that I learned and understood who I am as a human being and as an African person. And so we put these on along with other items. So when you see the staff that was selected by the ancestors in the pastor's possession to be the communal ancestral staff, you will see bells, raffia, other items, cowrie shells that will be added. But when we do libation going forward, when we do libation going forward, we will be carrying that staff. When we take the trek to Sankofa Square, we will be carrying that staff. Wherever our ancestors walk, they will walk with us with this ancestral staff. And so what was asked of our two elders, because of the work they have done, not only for us in the U.S., but the work that they have done globally in helping us to restore and recover our African mind has been recognized worldwide, as well as they have assumed the responsibility. They have said yes to the spirit realm, that they were willing to do the work of leading and guiding us, of helping us heal and become whole again, as Baba Before Asa would say, before trouble. And so we are so grateful. We are so grateful for you. And so I am going to now turn it over to them, and they will impart all that they bring through the ancestors and through the ultimate reality into our ancestral staff.
I want to thank this family for having us here. I'm kind of a old school teacher, and so I will teach you a moment. This is my granddaughter. I'm going to ask Talia to come up here, and she's going to hold the microphone so that her grandmother and her granddaddy can be heard. The role of the young is to make way and to take on the traditions that they've been given. So that's going to be her job, even though she's bashful. I also want to share with you that in our tradition, it is believed that ritual is the dramatization of consciousness. Ritual is the dramatization of consciousness. We, as Africans in America, have taken everybody else's ritual, from putting green stuff on our baby's shirts to all the crazy stuff that we do, but that's their consciousness. So what we're doing is reclaiming our consciousness through ritual. And in this ritual, what I would like to do is to join up the masculine and the feminine. Because the masculine and the feminine are never competing. They are not even complementary. They are completion. The masculine and feminine are completion. She is my completion. I am her completion. And so with this responsibility, we're going to recite some words that represent this ritual. And I will tap this table because that energy, and I want you all to think, if you want to say out loud, an ancestor's name. Because they're here. They're here in this room right now. So you can think their ancestor's name or you can say out loud, Annie Mae. Because I know Annie Mae is always with me. You see, so you can call her the name as we invite our ancestors here. Then I'm going to, she's going to hold that for you, baby. Yeah, that's a complete job. I'm going to start with the ritual. Start with the ritual for the ancestors. I bless my eyes that I will see their wisdom. I bless my mouth that I will speak their wisdom. I bless my heart that I will know their wisdom. I bless my ori, my mind, so I will always understand where to go at the right time. Our blessing, our blessing, our blessing. And with this blessing, the energy of my spirit comes through this staff. I want you to see this is not hocus pocus here. This is science. The energy of this spirit comes through this staff and goes to my completion, where she will give her words.
I'm asking for divine energy to come and form around us in the language of the Congo. Tulamuna Tumba, that we may be blessed, blessed, blessed. Tulamuna Tumba, that we may be protected, 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 protected. Tulamuna Tumba, that we may be healed, 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 healed. Tulamuna Tumba, that we may be loved, 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 loved. Tulamuna Tumba, that we may be forgiven, 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 forgiven. Tulamuna Tumba, that we may be successful, 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 successful. Tulamuna Tumba, that we may be regenerated, 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 regenerated. Tulamuna Tumba, that we may bless, protect, heal, and purify our surroundings of your surroundings of your perfect ways. Ashe, ashe, ashe.
And it was this moment. There you go, baby. This is no longer a stick. This is no longer a staff. It is the abode of our ancestors. It is the abode of our ancestors. And in this sacred place, I ask you to always bow down to the wisdom of our ancestors. And when you see this staff, understand that you are seeing the home of our ancestors. It is sacred. I want you to say it again. Ashe.
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 It is impossible to continue to oppress a consciously historical people. Any group of people who is conscious of its history can't be oppressed. You can hold them down for a minute, they will always remobilize. And the oppressor knows that, and that's why we're fighting wars literally right now to try to get information about our people out in front of our people.
Dr. Asa Grant Hilliard III was an extraordinary educator and renowned expert on the history and culture of ancient Egypt. Also known as Nana Bafour, Dr. Hilliard made rigorous scholarship and analysis to document the contributions of ancient African civilizations, his passion and life's work. Though death is a part of life, the shock of Dr. Hilliard's passage to becoming an ancestor makes many of us feel a sense of immeasurable loss. He is now among the latest in a long line of ancestors whom African-descended people around the world should emulate and honor. At the time of his death, Dr. Hilliard was the Fuller E. Calloway Professor of Urban Education at Georgia State University. He started his teaching years in the Denver public school system after earning his BA at the University of Denver, where he also earned his MA in counseling and a doctorate degree in educational psychology. 18 years on the faculty of San Francisco State University culminated in his final 8 years there as Dean of Education. Dr. Hilliard was a founding member of the Association for the Study of Classical African Civilizations, a prodigious scholar. His works included the TV series Free Your Mind, Return to the Source, African Origins, along with the many videos and educational materials he disseminated through his production company, Wasset Educational Productions. Mee's relationship with Dr. Hilliard extends back to even before the very beginnings of this firm. He always generously made his wisdom and extraordinary mind available to guide Mee's research with the underserved people in the African diaspora, with a particular focus on Black youth. His calm advice and visionary spirit informs much of Mee's work and our consciousness as individuals. Dr. Hilliard was one of the key experts Mee interviewed as part of our Black youth sexuality study, This Is My Reality, The Price of Sex. One of Mee's most proud collaborations with Dr. Hilliard was our work on First People, Our People, Ancient Egypt Revealed. This documentary was based on one of the many lecture series Dr. Hilliard offered during the summer months to what he called members of the royal family. The five-city tour of the Nile Valley region that Mee took in the years 1998 and 2000 changed the lives of all of us who were privileged to attend. Just this summer, we have been collaborating with Dr. Hilliard to produce an updated version of First People that targets the younger hip-hop generation. He believed that an intergenerational transmission of our values and culture was critically important. Dr. Hilliard was convinced that young people need to understand the truth of their ancestry because those who know their history and about the contributions Africans have made to human advancement and world history would understand that they have the potential to achieve all things. Through his own work and mentoring of many other scholars and knowledge seekers, Dr. Hilliard has touched the lives of tens of thousands directly and indirectly with his devotion to African deep thought. He earned the love and respect of both his fellow scholars around the world and the common man seeking enlightenment at the community bookstore. Dr. Asa Hilliard III will be truly missed, but never forgotten. His leadership as a devoted truth seeker and truth teller is an inspiration to us all.
I've said on many occasions that the highest priority that I have for the rest of my life
is the issue of socialization. Because under normal circumstances, what a community that is a community obligates itself to do is intergenerational cultural transmission. That we pass on our values, beliefs, behaviors to our children. And that is probably the most serious task that we perform.
So now if my brother can start me up, I want to share with you some thoughts about what you need to do. You know, you walk up on a man like that fast. I had a flashback. I forget I was in the chapel. Okay, you gonna stop me up? Okay. I want to share with you that there is probably no separation between me and Asa Hilliard, that I was honored, and it wasn't even a hesitation. All you had to say was, Asa wants you to be here. And I believe that Asa is with us. He's just transitioned to the invisible realm. And so I want to try to share some slides and have a conversation with the family. And I want to do that by saying, Jid Asa Irt Asa. It is the metal netcha. It means do Asa, speak Asa. So we don't have our great ones pass on and we talk about them. We see what is the best part of them that we can take and use in guidance for our own lives.
It's 8 o'clock.
And so my thing tells me it's 8 o'clock, but that's probably Texas time. And so what I want to do is talk about Asa Grant Hilliard III, and I have these stars because in our tradition, when we transition, we become a star. And since we are the oldest people in the world, I suspect that all the stars you see in the atmosphere are your folk. They are your people. And so, in fact, we have a tradition of being stargazers. And the reason why we're stargazers wasn't because we were just bored, we were stargazers to look and see what our ancestors were bringing to us. Okay, go to the next one, please, brother. And we're going to do this kind of song. We're going to go to the next one, if he will. And I want to spend time talking about you and fast. Go back and so I can say my personal remembrances, because that's an important part.
Yes.
Because it is a personal conversation I want to have with you about this walk that we did together in rescuing, reclaiming the African mind. That, I think, we evolved to. We first started out in ancient education, me in psychology, fighting white folks about what they didn't do right. And then it became a shift, and I hope I show you this in this presentation. The shift became, there's no need to be fighting white folks. I mean, we got to fight them and keep them from doing all the crazy stuff. But the fact of the matter, our mission should be the reawakening of ourselves. Because if we reawaken ourselves, we will do what light does. When light is turned on, the dark knows what to do. When light is turned on, the dark knows what to do. So we need to turn on our light. And I think Ace and I begin to realize that in terms of this issue. The Hilliard family and the Nobles family have been one family for over 45 years, close to 50 years. Our children became brothers and sisters. They called me uncle. My children called him uncle. They were not cousins. They were brothers and sisters. My wife, Vera, and Patsy Joe, Ace's wife, had the same birthday, August 20th. And Ace and I would talk on the side behind their back about how it is to live with these Leo women. Asa and Patsy Joe brought their children to our house when we celebrated Kwanzaa almost every year for close to 30 years. We traveled to Africa together. I became a Nana, a development chief in Ghana, and interesting enough, only Nanas can make another Nana. I didn't know that when I first became a Nana, but we were asked, both Dr. Akbar and myself, who became Nanas, were asked who would we want to introduce as a new Nana, and Asa became the person. So we, as almost like a gangster way, you know, blood in and blood out kind of stuff, we identified Asa as an important person. And so we recommended Asa as a nana, and we were there at his installment where he became Balfour Amon Quartier II. Asa wrote, I wrote the foreword in Asa's book, Saved by the Reawakening of the African Mind, and Asa wrote the foreword in my book, Seeking the Saku Foundations for the African Psychology. I'm gonna do like this. Maybe that makes it, tells you to move on. Okay, he's back there asleep. Got me? Okay, and so, go next, please. Go next. And so, I want to tell the story because Asa should be seen as almost like a sacred text. And we get kind of nervous when we talk about sacred text because whether we're Muslim or Christian or Hindu, we think that there's only one of the book that's a sacred text. But each of us is a sacred text. Each of us is a sacred text. And so, I want to cast Asa as a sacred text. And he was a gifted, valuable, unique human being. He loved life to the fullest. I want to point out, Asa also loved to teach and he loved to eat. I think he might have loved to eat more than he loved to teach. I'm not sure. I remember when my wife and I would visit Asa, Asa decided after the lecture that he wanted to invite us to go to have a dinner at the Raw Live Food Place in Atlanta. Now, Asa is my buddy. So I said, Asa, don't be encouraging stuff. My wife's a vegan. Now, I'm trying to stay cool. I only eat vegetarian fried chicken. She's a vegan. So I said, Asa, don't be encouraging me. Asa got us, he packed us in his car, and he literally started racing across Atlanta. He was racing. I said, my rear's in the front seat, I'm in the back seat. I'm worried about Asa Naga. He's speeding. I said, now either Asa is taking some place where there's really, really good food, or he's worried about the store going to close, or maybe he's having a flashback and the hounds of hell are chasing us through the dark waters of Atlanta. But we finally got there. And Asa literally said that he, next please. Asa literally said, you're going to love it, you're going to love this. And he talked about this food. And he said that, eat this food. Now I looked at the place and it was all raw food. Now, I'm a deep fry oil person. Asa was talking about all this food, and they were wearing these cucumbers and beans and stuff, and Vera and Asa were in vegan heaven. They were, and Asa, you said, I have to share this with you. Asa would eat and enjoy, he would smack his lips. He would just smack his lips. So Asa was smacking his lips, and I'm trying to find, we're going to get to someplace to eat the real food. But I love this woman, so I'm going, whatever her play is, I'm going back it, right? So I'm having this food, and Asa takes us back home. And so the next day, Asa and I went in the cut, by just he and I, to detox from the vegan food. And Asa told me, don't you tell Patsy Joe what I'm eating. He swore an oath. He said, don't tell Patsy Joe what I'm eating. So I swore an oath to my brother. I never told Patsy Joe that he didn't eat fried chicken. He didn't eat fried fish. He didn't eat roast beef. He didn't eat, but he did. And I never told Pastor Joe that issue. But I want to point out that we've had a love affair as two men, loving each other and loving our attempt to reawaken the African mind. And so I want to start with these things. It's really the seeking of the African mind that has been our mission. Seeking this African mind. And our master teacher, John Henry Clark, says that if we are going to be masters of our destiny, we must be masters of the ideas that influence that destiny. It's the ideas. And you know the ideas we've been given. You know, black people are dumb, big, thick lips, fat noses, kinky hair, all the stuff they've given us about who we are as ideas. But those ideas become the substance of behavior. And so we got to make sure we rescue and stand on the proper ideas. And I've tried to add to that by saying we got to rescue our being, make it more better, and drink deeply from the wellspring of African being, episteme, thought, and knowing. Now, sometimes you say episteme, people, they still shut down. But all episteme is how you know what you know. So when you go to the club and you look around and you say, this is some gangster stuff's about to happen, you're doing an epistemological analysis. At the club. So I want you to understand that these things, that we got to grasp and understand these ideas. Next, please. And so there's some further guys. These are people that I really respect a lot. Frantz Fanon. if you don't know him, you might want to go seek him out. He, in fact, he was a psychiatrist that became a revolutionary. As Frantz Fanon said, those made wretched of the earth must rescue their humanity. Those made wretched of the earth must rescue their humanity in history from the dark, dank dungeons that the racial colonizers had confined us to, and completely topple. Don't compromise. Don't say, can we just get along? Don't ask, can I get a corner in your room, in your house? He said, you must completely topple the racial colonized world. Ace's cousin, Jay Carruthers said, the African scholar practitioner, that's all of us. Yeah. I want you to think, if you think a thought, you a scholar. If you think a thought, now the problem is that we think the wrong thoughts. Right. We think that all the thoughts we've been trained in the Western world, but you think a thought, you're a scholar. Jake said, African scholar practitioners must break the chains that link African ideas to European ones. Yes. To listen to the voice of the ancestors without European interpretation. That's a hard task. Because all of us in this room have been trained, educated in the Western model of what it is to even think. And so Jake said, no, you got to do that. You got to rescue our stuff and break it and listen to the voice of the ancestors without European interpretations. So don't understand a thought of our ancestors and then translate it to some French, German, Portuguese philosopher that you learned in sophomore high school that you think everything filters through them. Jake says, ultimately, I think this is important, ultimately, knowing is the result of a divine, universal, and intergenerational conversation. That's what brought my granddaughter up here, because it's got to always be thinking about intergenerational, what we old folks will pass to the next folks will pass to the invisible ones, and the invisible ones will seed those who are yet to be born. That's our path. And so he says, this intergenerational conversation among God, the creator, the cosmos, nature, and the creatures of the earth, especially we human beings. I have since moved away from it. I'll show you in a minute. We're not human beings, but I'll tell you about that in a minute, because I don't want you all to get frightened. I'm saying you ain't a human. You're going to get frightened. Just hold on. And then he says, then Asa says, it is time to take charge of our tools. It's time to take charge of our tools. You know the toolbox is where? It's in your head. It's in your head. It is time to take charge of our tools, our problem definitions, our priorities, and to change directions. It is time to reach out for excellence. We must have a mission to assume greater responsibility and control over our children's socialization and to push for education for critical consciousness. Critical consciousness, that's just I'm aware. No, critical consciousness, being able to discern what is you and what ain't you. Right. Be able to discern what you need to do and what you should not do. And then finally, Kwame Nkrumah says, I am not African because I was born in Africa, but because Africa was born in me. All y'all take that home with you. And if you see any recent continental Africans talk about you and Africans, slap them in the face. Tell them, I'm African, not because I came from Nigeria, from Ghana, from South Africa, I'm African because Africa is born in me. And I want you to hold on to that and feel that. Let it resonate with you. Africa is born in you. He says, all people of African descent, whether they live in North or South America, the Caribbean, or any part of the world, are Africans and belong to the African nation. Kwame says, it is clear we must find an African solution to our problems. Divided we are weak, united Africa could become one of the greatest forces of good in the world. Now, I think that if I could just sort of critique my hero's thinking, it is not our job to make the world better. It is our job to be better. And when we be better, the world vibrates off of us. Yes. Vibrates off of us. See, the problem is that we don't know what it is to be. Yes. So therefore, we just take anybody's stuff. Next, please. So our love affair with Africa, that's why I think it is. Ace and I had love affair with Africa. His book, Seba, my book, Saku, are all really compilations of. And I don't think they're scholarly books. I think they're contributions. We're giving you all a contribution, and we ask you, I hope this contribution will be worthy of your reading. And if it's worthy of your reading, I hope it will guide your doing. That's what scholarship is about. I hope it's worthy of your reading, and if it's worthy of reading, it will guide what you're doing. And so Asa talks about whitening of Africa. He talked about the importance of cultural heritage. He talked about Sabbath. He talked about the process of transformation. And I talk about the nasty nine. I'm going to show who they are in a minute. Ontological invariance. That's a lot of stuff out your mouth. Ontological invariance. People, I can't say that. But you can say MF. I'm an old school teacher. I want to point out to you, don't be hiding behind something. You know, you go and say, well, I can't do this. I can't say that. No, we can do anything we want to because we are unlimited. All right? And I talk about culture as restorative technology. Next, please. And so from Ace's mind, I'm gold mining. Ace's mind. Next. Ace says, there is no excuse for our next generation to be uninformed about our global history, our culture, and the world leadership and civilization from ancient times to present. There is no excuse. He says, we must reverse the loss of our children through alien socialization. And all of us have been attacked by the aliens. Aliens are those teachers that taught you. Even some black places, black teachers, have been internalized to the alien thought and they've taught. So we've all been taught by the aliens. This is like a Starship kind of story. Moonbeams coming out. We've been taught by the aliens. And so Asa says, we must reverse the loss of our children through alien socialization. We can do it. We can do it. We can do it. We have not failed. We just ain't tried. Wow. From the mind of Asa Hilliard, he says, we always have to be clear about who has what agenda, including all of us. Allies are not always who they appear to be. Hence, vigilance with critical conscience is our best ally. Asa's spirit says, will be with us for as long as the sun shines and the water flows. Asa's spirit will be us for as long as the sun shines and the water flows. Next, please. So Asa finally says, and per Asa Hilliard, he introduces in Stolen Legacy, mental bondage is invisible violence. Mental bondage. Absolutely. The doggish police shoot our children down in the streets. Some deranged black folks shoot each other in the streets. That's violence. But Ace is pointing out, widening the scale, that mental bondage is invisible bondage. Formal physical slavery has ended in the United States, but mental slavery continues to this very present day. This slavery affected the minds of all people in one way. It is worse than physical slavery alone. I want you to stop and think about that for a minute. We all think, you know, I got a job, I'm the supervisor of this, I'm the PhD that, I'm the chair of this. You've got all this, and some of us are doing good. Some of us are doing good. We actually got our house paid for. Talia, why you let me not speak this so they can hear me? Where are you? And so, thank you, Pastor. And so, yeah, because I just, I'm ready to dance up in here, so, I'm going to have just break up and throw a cape over my back. And so, he says, the slavery affected the minds of all our people, and in one way, it is worse than physical slavery alone. That is, persons who are in mental bondage will be self-contained. Self-contained. Think about that. I contain myself. I don't need someone to say, you can't do it. I tell myself, I can't do it. And how many of us have been taught to say, I can't do it? Yes. Babies in schools, I can't learn. I can't do this. I can't take the test for this promotion. We've been taught to self-contain ourselves. Next, please. And so from my mind, and that's a dangerous place to be, I think. from my mind, next, please. I want to stop here. I use this map of Africa because I want to point out a side note. Almost three-fourths of Africa are Bantu people. We are Bantu people. But because the colonizers came and took a crayon, literally took a crayon, and divided up Africa and said, now you Igbo, you Fulani, you Ghana, you Nigeria, and now we fight each other. And we inherited that, so now I'm a Blood, you a Crip, you West Side, I'm East Side. You see, that crayon, we've been assaulted by the crayon that the crayon has made us self-contained. So I can't walk across the block because I'm in someone else's turf. See, that's the thing that we need to see, that these ideas, and I think the way we break out is what I'm calling the paradigm shift. We got to shift paradigms. We got to shift focus. Next, please. Now, here's what I want to shift very quickly, because they're so invisible, we don't think about it, except we sort of kiss their rings when we're going to college, right? But These are white supremacist intelligentsia. They are men of lying and deception. But we were taught to honor them, to honor them. But these nine men created all these things that we are suffering from. The dehumanization of African people, the ugliness of African people, the mental incapacity of African people. So these nine, I coined them as the nasty nine, and I was sorry I did that, but now I got to live with it because I woke up in Canada and I rock and roll the nasty nine. And you all go away talking about the nasty nine too if you want to, but if you're in graduate school, be careful because these are their sacred folk. But understand who they are. You might have to pass a test about George Wilhelm Hegel. You might have to pass a test about Sigmund Freud if you're in psychology. You might have to pass a test by George Friesen if you were doing Egyptology. You might have to pass a test, but understand who they really are. These are the men from starting back in the 1700s. This white elite in support of white supremacy created a thought prism. You know what a prism is? What diffracts light? It created a thought prism of false narrative, lies, and deceit regarding Africa and the meaning of being African that has polluted and contaminated all thinking and behavior toward African culture, people, place in the world. I grew up believing that I was not African. And if I wanted to insult somebody, I said, oh, you black African. I put something on it. It was not just to be African. I got to put something real on. You're a black African. I grew up with that stuff, see? And these are the men that created that thought prism. And we didn't even know it. Wow. We didn't know. We just walked around and did what we did. And same thing with the N-word. Now, I'm going to say the N-word because it has a toxic sound. Nigga! I want you to go in your privacy of your homes and say it in the closet by yourself. Just say, nigga! And feel the toxicity of the word itself. And now our children say it like it's their first name, as we did when we were youngsters. But unfortunately, because we are the mouths of the world, our children got all the other folk. They got Chinese saying, what's up, nigga? They got Hispanics saying, nigga this. They got white folks saying, nigga this. You see, so we got to understand the power of languaging in this paradigm that was shot in. So these people did it. They created this thinking and behavior toward African culture and people and place in the world. These nine white race men established the idea of dehumanization, the idea of denigration, the idea of demeaning, the idea of inferiorization for African people, and it's ingrained in every single subject matter that you study in the world. I don't get whether it's physics or chemistry, it's everywhere. But because we don't pull them out and pull the cloth off them, we don't know that they're there. We don't know that we're absorbing this. We're just thinking we're getting higher education. We're thinking we're getting a good education. We think, I got an A in that. No, but you understand, I say this because I don't want to spend a lot of time with them, but I'm saying these are the bandits. These are the toxic nine, the nasty nine. Next, please. Nasty. Now, I want to add this to you. Now, okay, take a breath, because I want you to let that negativity get away from you. The nasty nine. I need to say this if I may, Pastor. When you go to the toilet and you start to do your business, first of all, it stinks. But after a while, you can't smell it no more. Think about that. If you don't believe me, go to the bathroom of the day when you go home. I'm an experimental psychologist. I test stuff out. Go to the bathroom. When you go in the bathroom, you start doing your business, it stinks. But after a while, it don't smell no more. That's Western thought. At first, we say, oh, what is this? Oh, what is this? Oh, what is this? But then after a while, you say, no, I'm a black Freudian. I'm a black Maslowian. I'm a black whoever, because it no longer stinks anymore. You see? So I want you to hold on to this and think about it. And again, if this is uncomfortable, just do what my master teacher said to me. I'm going to teach you something. If it fits, use it. If it don't, throw it in the ash can of history. Don't say, oh, Dr. Noble said this, now I got to struggle. No, if it don't make no sense with you, throw it in the ash can of history, because what's my trump card is the ancestors going to come back to you later on. You might be 80 years old, come back to you, and you have a revelation. You see it. And so these ideas about the Moko Jumbi. You know the Moko Jumbi is the stilt walkers. And now they've taken out Moko Jumbi and made them entertainment for carnivals and dances and shows. But the Moko Jumbi were very important. The Moko Jumbi were healing spirit beings that watched over the community. And from its high, high towered place on those stilts, it could see and foresee evil coming. That was the job of the Mokuzumi, to see and foresee evil coming, or to see, foresee what needs afar off needs to be brought to the community to heal itself, to mend itself, Mokuzumi. So the Mokuzumi were two legs, and I've reclaimed this idea, and trying to take it away from being just carnival entertainment and talk about it as a pedagogical instrument that we can use to remind ourselves. The Mokuzumi, the two legs of the Mokuzumi is good symbolic representation for the dual task. I want you to hold on to the dual task of decolonizing the African mind and affirming African being. That to me is our dual task. We have to decolonize our African minds and we have to affirm our African being. So now here's the Mokuzumi. Left leg up, right leg up. Left leg decolonized the African mind. Right leg up, affirming African being. So can you imagine we have our children do a dance? Do a dance where they know that every time they touch the left leg. Or we teach our children, go in the classroom, and every time we teach some crazy stuff, wiggle your left leg. I'm not taking that stuff. Every time you get some good stuff, wiggle that right leg. And think about it. My mind may be dangerous. I think about when we were growing up, brothers get on the corner, and they'll put the left foot forward. What's that about? Maybe the brother was saying, even though I ain't got nothing, I'm on the block. All I got is this block, but I put my left foot forward because I'm decolonizing my mind. I ain't going for the okey-doke that the white folks tell me that because you a thug or because you out of prison or because you can't learn that you ain't nobody. So I want you to, I want you to start seeing with African eyes. Seeing with a paradigm shift. Change the shift so you can start seeing stuff. We do a lot of stuff that's African. We don't even know we're doing that. I think the two things that we do over and over again is I study deeply the history of African people is that we struggle to free our minds, Issa Hilliard, decolonize the African mind, and we struggle to rescue what is ours, affirming African being. I've been telling my young people out in California, you all excited about this AI. Everybody's AI, artificial intelligence. I want to take AI and say African intentional. Maybe that's our AI. That we're gonna intentionally be African. That's our AI. Now I want you also to study this AI because there's some dangerous stuff going on there. So we got to study that, especially people who are in the technology. Tell your young people to study that, but study that with that shield of what? Left leg wiggle, right leg wiggle. We got to do that. So this idea, one leg affirming African beingness, one leg decolonization of the African mind. Next, please. So the affirmation of African mind, I'm giving you a shopping list now. There's work for y'all to do. This ain't entertainment up in here. There's work for you to do. If we are to affirm African being, we must accept a fundamentally different meaning of being human and continue to address some specific things. Understand being spirit. Being spirit. In fact, I've coined a term for black psychologists I call dim. You know, your mama talk about dim kids, dim people, dim folk. I didn't realize that my mama was saying, baby, I want to remind you, you're divine energy made manifest. Yeah. So big mama was saying, dim kids better behave themselves, because what? You divine. Or your mama whip you behind and say, you know better. Hold up, mama, you ain't told me about that. Why you beat me now? You said, you know better. You ain't told me not to do that. But she did it because she saw you as dim. Dim people, divine energy made manifest. So we got to understand being spirit, not being physically human. And that's sort of esoteric, but I want you to hold on to it for a while. Again, the answers are going to bring it to you. If you don't get it now, you get it later. And then engage in both visible and invisible realms of reality. Yes. Don't make the invisible spooky. You made it spooky. We make the visible spooky. You know, they say, I had a dream about my grandmother. Don't tell me that. I don't hear about that. No, she dead. No. We got to understand both the visible and the invisible. And then, now this is important. Honor the feminine as primary and paramount. Stop. Honor the feminine as primary and paramount. This ain't no gender equity conversation. This ain't no gender fluidity conversation. This ain't no gender diversity. It is to recognize that the portal of heaven, the portal of heaven is between a black woman's legs. Woo! Now, this is okay to say that in the chapel, yes? Yes, 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 yes. The portal to heaven is through a black men's, black woman's legs. The primary and fundamental paramount beingness of what we call humanity is the feminine. Now, we got to study that with African eyes. Because you go study with their eyes, you start looking about all the stuff about, you know, I'm a white woman and I want the same thing you, or I'm a white woman and you make me feel uncomfortable. All of those crazy. No, no. We got to really look at this stuff and understand it from our own paradigm. You know what I'm saying? Paradigm shift. We got to shift the paradigm and begin to understand these things. And when we understand this woman is primary and paramount, I can say that this is my completion. This is my completion. In fact, I can say, which I do a lot sometimes, and she's probably tired of saying, I can say that this woman here, she belongs to me. You know, brothers know that stuff, right? This is my old lady. She belonged to me. Sometimes she don't belong to you. She got her own self. She don't belong to you. No, she belongs to me. Not own her. She belongs to me. She belongs to me like my hand belongs to the end of my arm. She belongs to me like my eyes belong in my face. She belongs to me like my heart is in my chest. She belongs to me like my stomach is in my belly. She belongs to me because without her, I am incomplete. See, that's primary and paramount. See, so we got to begin. Now we got to talk about how do we teach young brothers to understand that this male-female relationship becomes a different kind of conversation if we start talking about it as we rescue African thought. Now understand, Africa is all messed up. So don't think you're going to run to Africa and get some insight. They mess up too. I mean, colonialism did a job on us. But what you can do, if you're blessed to have an old living relative, sit with them and ask them, what did your mama teach you as a child? Just some of the old school stuff, that old school stuff. Like I can talk about how we would be playing in the yard down the street, and my father would call us up down the street, up three flights of stairs, and say, baby, hand me that glass of water. Now, because he was 6'4" and weighed 340 pounds, I didn't challenge him. But in my mind, I said, man, he's lazy. But he wasn't being lazy. He was teaching me a profound divine lesson. The responsibility of the youth is to make the elder life better, easier. So, see, we got to start studying ourselves with African eyes. African eyes, African mouth, African heart, African mind. And so, understand that the sacred meaning of being human. We are sacred beings. And that's not saying we go to church a lot. I hope you go to church or you go someplace where you can take a moment to contemplate the theology of the divine being. But that's what I'm talking about. I walk around as a sacred being. I walk around. I don't want to get in your offering pot. Yeah, I don't want to get in that. But the fact is, man, you ain't got to be here to do this. All you got is to look at the mirror, and you see God.
See God.
So we got to begin to talk about that. But then when it comes to these places, because this is a place of celebration and a strong reminder, if it's done right. Now, I'm Christian. I'm also Muslim. I'm also Hindu. I'm also Buddha. I'm also Ifa. I'm also Santeria. I'm also Contemplé, because I'm what? I'm them. I'm divine energy made manifest. I'm them. Divine energy made manifest. So again, here's a shopping list. And leave this with you. You can pick this up and say, I think I want to handle support cultural maturation and spiritual evolution. Because I'm a principal of a high school. So that's my major goal, support cultural maturation and spiritual evolution. Every text, every assignment, every job I give my kids, they got to be tied to their spiritual evolution and cultural maturation. Or I may decide that I'm going to reinvent the Boy Scouts, and I'm going to invent rites of passage and achievement ceremonies. Not no get no badge for fishing or get no badge for sewing, but get a badge that says, here's how you walk in the world as a black man. Here's how you stand up. Thank you. Now, see that grandchildren just take over you and say, now you ain't doing it right. Get up. But James Brown knows how to keep his mic in front of him. I've studied him. I don't really know how to do that well, but I've tried. But again, look at this. Maybe I should take the responsibility. I'm a police officer. I'm a police officer in the black community. I should take the responsibility, defend the right and responsibility to walk in the world as a unique and valuable human with an African face. There are a whole bunch of faces out there, but I want to make sure I defend. The cops have service on their cars. That's sort of strange. But I want to say now, defend the right and responsibility to walk in the world as a unique and valuable human being with an African face. Protect the cultural character of one's ancestral lineage. Everybody should be able to, we should now start thinking about how do we teach our children to recite their lineage. I'm Wade Nobles. My daddy's name was John Nobles. My daddy's daddy's name was Mims Nobles. My daddy's name was daddy's name was Wade Nobles. I am Wade Nobles, who's my daddy's great-grandfather. Right. Now that's just not this naming. I might have some of the spiritual energy of this dude called Wade Nobles, who was enslaved in Edgefield, South Carolina. So I got to think about that. And then when I begin to realize that, I study as much as I can about who that guy was. And he was a man that was strong and loved children. I can't do that. I beat you behind when they don't do right, but I love children. You see? So you gotta look at your ancestral lineage, because each of you come with a template. Now some of that template you got to clean up. Because something's been imposed on you. Sometimes you get some mutation going on in there. So you gotta clean it up. That don't mean you don't reject your lineage, you just clean it up. And in fact, the traditional sciences say that some of my ailments are things that happened to my ancestors. So I got to heal the wounds of my ancestors if I can heal myself. That's a big, big job to do that, because we don't even know how to think about how do I heal the ancestors who are in the afterlife. And so to minimize personal trauma and shattered conscience. Next one, please. I'm going fast because I want you all to have this. But then this other lay, what's this lay? That's decolonize that from mine. We got that left leg. All right? So here, we got to figure out how do we dismantle the edifice of white hegemony. Everything in this world is about white privilege. I mean, white people can do all kinds of strange stuff and get away with it. And white women can call the police on a little black girl who's selling lemonade, and the police will actually come out and arrest her. What kind of crazy stuff is that? You see, so we got to figure out how to dismantle this white hegemony. We got to deconstruct the implicit privilege of white thought. I've had a career being an African, black teacher, professor, and I go to these, I don't do them anymore, but I go to these multicultural diversity panels. Some of you have to do those. I said you do, but you need to have your voices, but I would not waste my time with multicultural diversity, anything. But some of you need to do that because you need to be in there on that force. But in those diversity panels in my history, I would say something, people disregard it. Little white boy, get up and say exactly what I say, get a standing ovation. Didn't I just say that? You see, so that's the idea. We got to dismantle this white, the privilege of white false. Disrobe the false image of the white aesthetic. Mm-hmm. And we got to think about that deeply, because some of us think that white aesthetic is good. In fact, us brothers will be supporting sisters the more they look like the white aesthetic. So we got to figure out how we shift ourselves and correct ourselves. Now, ain't no fault in deciding some cosmetic change that makes your life easier. Yes. If you want to wear your hair a certain way because it's easy to get, do that. But don't do it because I want to mimic someone else. Yes. So that's the thing I want to make. And then we got to challenge and correct the singularity of this materialistic ontology. That's not big words now. But the materialist ideology says that it ain't real if it's not measurable, touchable, feelable. So this is real. That ain't real. But that is, I'm gathering in the energy of the divine energy. You see? So we got to understand, we can't just limit ourselves to the materialist thought. And then engage in the identification and the elimination of dehumanizing systems. And I give a list of them. You all can play them. Institutional oppression, class privilege, appropriation. People take our stuff, give it back to us, and we try to do them doing us. See, that's crazy. And then sexism, disenfranchised, apostolic authority, enslavement, commodification, menticide, place, stay in your place, boy, racism, colorism, genetic, that's your list there. We can start thinking about it. These are the stuff that we got to what? Dehumanize. This is the left leg, Moko Jumbi dance. Yeah. Moko Jumbi dance. Then we get on the right foot, reaffirming the African, right? So we want to make that go. Next, please. Next, please. But I would suggest that maybe in your study groups, maybe in your mending, you pick up one. You can't do them all. We can't do them all. We're going to take one. And for the next six, if I'm a therapist, quote therapist, I could take one and ask my client population, let's work with this for the next 6 weeks. See how your life changes in terms of your, how you feel as you walk in the world. That's what I'm offering these to you for. It's something you can do. And so grounded in spirit. I like this image. Remember the Bantu? Three-fourths of Africa are Bantu people. And not only three-fourths of Africa are Bantu people, all of the diaspora are Bantu people. Everywhere you find an African in the diasporic world, Cuba, Haiti, Brazil, Jamaica, United States, Canada, England, Sweden, wherever we were spread, it was the Bantu people coming. And so if you think about it, we look at how we preach. When we get real excited in our preaching, it's that Bantu to come out. It's the Bantu to come out. We don't say it that because no one ever said, you Bantu. Like I think Dr. Martin Luther King was a Bantu preacher. And when he started having his visions and talking about what he's seen on the mountaintop, that's Bantu stuff. If you go study our philosophy and our tradition, you see it there. So I like this because this is, again, that completion. The brother, look at the brother. He's sitting on a palm. And what emerges out of him is the spirit of the primary and the feminine. Because we're not disconnected. We should not be even tolerating any fighting against men and women. And you got stuff and I ain't got stuff. You know, we shouldn't even tolerate that. That should be unacceptable for us as a people. Because I can't be me without she. Yes. She can't be her without me. So we got to, that's the paradigm shift. I want to hear the word. That's the paradigm. How do we shift the paradigm? So everything we do comes that way. Next, please. So spirit, now this is where I am now. And I just gave Rev a book, and this is not a commercial. Some of my books out there, if y'all want to buy them and give them to your grandchildren, if you don't read, do that. Give them to your grandchildren to read. But I think we need to start studying stuff. And again, if it don't make sense, throw it in the ash can of history. But in my latest book, I talk about not black psychology, but the science of being. The science of being. We be. We be. And part of our moral mandate is what? To be more better. I can stand in front of you without bragging and tell you, you are witnessing one of the best, baddest black psychologists you ever seen. By none. And tomorrow, I'm going to be more better. That should be the mantra of all of us. Whatever you do, I'm the best carpenter there is. Tomorrow, I'm going to put something on and be more better. See, that's what we should do. And so I think the spirit is important. Spirit. Spirit is like energy. And the only Western discipline I draw from is quantum physics. Not sociology, not psychology, not anthropology. It's quantum physics. Because the quantum physicists are now realizing what our ancestors knew 3,000 years ago. But because they hid our stuff, lied about our stuff, we don't go investigate those. But it is energy. We are energy. We are vibrating, radiating energy. Let me back up off of you. We are vibrating, radiating energy. In fact, I vibrate and radiate in 7 different directions while standing still. That's my energy field. And in fact, you can see, if you think about it, when black people start doing stuff, sports you see it a lot, one player on the team will get hot, and everybody start doing better, catching better, running better, dropping. What's going on there? That's energy transmission. That's energy, vibrating, radiating energy. And what the Bantu Congo have taught me is that not only am I vibrating, radiating energy, I am a trifold vibrating, radiating energy field. Yeah. Trifold. I am yet to be born. I am born. I am in the afterlife. Three stages, all vibrating and radiating in 7 different directions. I vibrated forward. I vibrated back. I vibrated left. I vibrated right. I vibrated down. And the most important vibration, I vibrated in. 7 different directions. I can stand still right now in front of you. My granddaughter gave me a sign. I can stand right in front of you, and I am vibrating in 7 directions. And what we're now learning in the science of being is that each direction has a healing potential.
That's right.
Each direction has healing potential. Left means one thing. Right means another, up and down. And now let's go back and look at our sisters who dance. Look at our dancers. Our dancers dance and whirl and swirl But you stop, you pick them and cut them and slap, you see, she's not doing left. She's not doing right. She's down doing down. Study ourselves, study ourselves, study everything we do with African eyes. Don't tell this is entertainment. Oh, she showed the dance. Oh, she shook that booty nice. No, study, look at that booty. Look at that booty. And that booty be going right, left, up, and down. Now, listen to this. I don't want y'all to get all excited and get entertainment. This ain't entertainment. This is serious work. We don't know that dancer shaking her booty in a certain way is addressing a particular damage or illness in her family. We don't know that because we ain't looked at it right. See, we ain't looked at it right. We ain't looked at this stuff right. And I want to get you paradigm shifting. I don't look at that. When old days, when sisters get married, she put her hand on her hip. She ain't mad. She was putting her head on the hip, which is a sign of Ka, spirit. So you done messed up now. And I can say, oh baby, I was out with Rev, and we get talking stuff, and we were doing theological understandings, but we were actually out there drinking. So I gotta make up some excuses here, right? But we don't see the signs. We don't see our signs. Our bodies are an encyclopedia of movement.
Yes.
And in our movement, there's memory.
Yes.
There's memory.
Yes.
And so when brothers are playing the piano in the honky tonk, they said, what is that? They're giving a vibratory energy sound that's doing something in my soul, and I don't know it. So we think we're just going down the club and getting drunk, but we might be going down the club and getting restored. You see? So we gotta think about everything. Think about that's what I'm pleading with you, to think about every movement that we make, because we are what? Them. If we divine energy made manifest, then I got to think about everything that divine does. And even when I think it might be wrong, go deeper into it. Look at it deeper and see what it's really about. And so this spirit is the life force or energy which comes from the divine all. Sometimes people call that divine all Allah or Jesus or Jehovah. But it's divine all.
Right.
Divine all. And how you label it depends on whether you speak French or English. That doesn't make no difference. Because the different languages have different terms for the divine all. It is the totality of being, becoming, and belonging to the divine all. I'm the totality. It is spirit is the divine spark which gives the being its beingness. Gives me my beingness. I be, but also there's a beingness, there's a belongingness, and there's a becomingness. So all those bees got to be played around with and work with. And the spirit is the evidence that humans belong to a divinely governed natural order. What Ace and I were talking about as socialization back in the day, we're really talking about being in alignment with a divinely governed natural order. That's how we socialize our children. And the spirit is that which enlivens the body and lives on after the body dies. There is no end. There is no end. When I transition, I'm gonna come back to this child's child. It might be this child's child, because my energy does never end, doesn't never dissolve, and it's over. Next, please. So now I've coined the term in black psychology, which I now call Sakushetti, which I'm saying we don't know adjective of white folk psychology. No, black is like the adjective. So we black psychologists to be a modification of them. No, we're not them. We have our own science, is what I'm trying to suggest to you. Our own science. So I said I entered a term called spiritness as opposed to spirituality. See, people give us credit. Oh, you black people are very all. They're so spiritual. We is spiritual. Yes, we is. But we're more than just spiritual. We are it. We are the spirit. And that spirit I'm calling spiritness. In S as a suffix means it is the thing, it is the noun form. So we are spiritness, not spiritual. We are spiritual. I don't want to get you away from it. I'm in the choir. What do you mean I ain't spiritual? I don't want you to go there. I don't want you to go there. I want you to realize that you could be spiritual and do certain tasks, but you walk in the world as divine energy, spiritness. So I say spiritness. Human beings experience their spiritness simultaneously as a metaphysical state in an ethereal condition that connects us into, between the superworld of the deities, the inner world of other beings, and the interworld of other beings, and the inner world of the self. So I'm connected to the superworld of the deities. I'm connected to the interworld of you and me. I'm connected to the interworld of me, all at the same time. That's why I can look over at the brother, and we be talking, and I'm saying one thing. He looking at my eyes, and he know I'm telling him, man, you got to stop that shit. You got to stop doing that. But I'm saying, how are you, Deacon? What you doing, man? Well, have you read the script? No, look at my eyes, and you know, faster than my whole car.
That's right.
You see? Because I'm connected. We are connected. And we need to maximize this way of being.
Yes.
That's what I think. We need to maximize this way of being. All right? And so spiritness is often misconceived as spiritual or religious quality. It is physics. It's literally quantum physics. It's not a quality. Next please. It's not a spiritual quality. Next one. And so I say that we are spirit beings. Now I'm declaring. I'm a scientist. And when I was first young, I'd be almost bashed to say I'm an intellectual or I'm a scientist, because you know Negroes ain't supposed to be intellectuals. So in my early days, I would kind of creep up on. Yeah. So, talk softly. I'm an intellectual. I'm a scientist. Because I was afraid someone was going to check me.
Yeah.
Say, you black, you ain't that. So I was worried. But now, look here, I'm an intellectual.
Yeah.
That's my craft. That's my work. That's what I do.
Yeah.
I'm an intellectual. I'm a scientist. That's what I do. And so as a scientist, intellectual, I can look at phenomena, this is what scientists do, and I can come up with a term that best captures the quality of that phenomena.
Yes.
That's called labeling. That's called categorization.
Yes.
You see? And so as a scientist, I've not come up with a term called spirit being. I'm saying that being human is to be energy, power, spiritness. We are spirit beings. The yellow is important. We are spirit beings housed in a physical container having a human experience.
Yes.
I'm housed in this physical container. And I'm thank God that the physical container kind of made me cool. Because my physical container attracted her, right? There's a reason for everything. That's my physical container. Now, if I was all distorted, I may have decided, as some people do, that I better change the thickness of my lips. I better trim my nose. I better cut my hair. All that's all physical stuff. I literally can't change the African spirit.
No.
It is like that movie, if you build it, they will come.
Yes.
If you acknowledge it, it will take over you.
Yeah.
If you acknowledge the African spirit. So we don't acknowledge the African spirit as what? As a knowing and knowable being. Our spirit knows stuff. It is a knowing and knowable spirit. And sometimes it comes to you and tells you stuff, you think, oh, I felt breeze. Ain't no breeze. Ain't no breeze. That's your ancestors say, hey, baby. You know. So we got to start looking at the world differently. That's what I'm pleading with you all to think about. Think about it. That spirit energy is all around us. And so this spirit being housing physical container. So I can deal with the physical container. I can deal with that. I can deal with the human experience. In fact, that's what we've been doing from the beginning of time as enslaved people, struggling with the physical human experience, fighting to be free. Engaging in slave revolts, revolutions, engaging in the civil rights movement, engaging in all these things, that's us dealing with this thing called the human experience. And we've also did some stuff with the physical container. We decided, you too black, you too fat, you too yellow, you too what? We start doing stuff with the cosmetics around the physical container. What we can do is this spirit being, this knowing and knowable spirit that I believe is now waking up. It's called the ancestors. They're waking up and telling us, it's time for you to be grown.
Yes.
It's like your mama did.
Yes.
At some point in your childhood, your mama saw that you were old enough to go to the store by yourself with the $2, buy some milk, and she said, and bring back the right change, buy some milk and bring it back home. Your mama said, you're old enough to have more responsibility.
Yes.
I believe the ancestors are saying to us now, y'all old enough. You've been spirit beings enough, it's time for you to walk in the world.
Yes.
Walk in the world as African beings. Walk in the world. Walk in the world.
Yes.
And understand that what I'm sharing with you, walk in the world. Every now and then, you can do the left leg.
Yeah. Yeah.
Every now and then, all the time you're doing the right leg. All the time the right leg. But every now and then, you got to recognize, wait a minute. They done hired me to be on the board of directors of General Motors. Whew. I'm the first Negro ever to be on the board of directors. Yeah, that's good. But when you get in that boardroom, understand the left leg. And the left leg. And in fact, if there's more than one or two of you in the boardroom, you all have that family talk. And you tell a brother, on this meeting, I'm going to be the left leg. I'm going to start shit. On this leg, you do that. If we know our stuff, we can do it. But the problem is we don't know our stuff. So we figure out how to do what they tell us to do. So I think that what I hope I'm delivering here is an understanding of who you are. Who you are, you dim people. In this sanctuary right now, dim people are hearing, I hope, what I'm saying, dim people. And so spirit beings, we are living sons. Look at the symbolism. The sun is the most powerful image of, it's the most powerful image of power any human in the world knows. The sun. And the Bantu say, is that we are a living sun. Each of us is a living sun, having unlimited power. But we don't know that. We think we just up from Alabama. And escaped from Alabama. And we're so glad to be away from this. See, but we are living sons possessing a knowing and knowable spirit. Now, here's an educational testing. If we are knowing and knowable spirit, you can't graduate from anywhere until you know a little bit of what your spirit knows. Now, do you know what your spirit knows? So no one even gave us a question. No one said, I want you to tell me something that your spirit knows. But your spirit has been eternal. In fact, I like to make this point with my students, is that African spirit that figured out how to build the Great Pyramids without a crane, without a screwdriver, without nails. Built that, and nobody else since then can replicate it. That's African spirit being known. So we got to tap into it. We got to think about, and I'm not saying that, but we haven't figured out how to do it yet. But we got to be able to tap into this knowing and knowable spirit. Thank you, baby. I just love it, man. My babies take care of me. And what I want her to do is get a nice 5-bedroom mansion in Jamaica and tell me and her grandmother, y'all can live here for 3 months out of the year. She's working on that. So we gotta give them goals. Give them goals. And look, this spirit being is a knowing and noble spirit, energy, power, like quantum physics, like Quela, like quantum. If you study those things, you'll see that this energy is never destroyed. It's never destroyed. It simply manifests and changes in different directions. Once it's liquid, now it's solid, now it's ether, smoke. The same thing as water, ice cube. See, that's who we are. We're like living ice cubes. And now we got to melt us, ice off of us. Shake off the ice, that's the European ice. Shake off the European ice and flow like the African spirit. And so the spirit being, as I said, trifold, unfolding experience. We're unfolding. Each of you are unfolding in terms of your what? Trifold. Three, you are yet to be born, you are born, you are afterlife. In fact, what you say today is imprinting. It may not be you because you don't have all the babies you're going to have, but what you say today is imprinting the new life that's coming forth from heaven in your family, in your bloodline. Yes. So be careful what you say. Be careful what you say. But what you say in your home is imprinting the new life that's coming through your bloodline. So be careful and be intentional. Yes. AI, African intention. Do that as we work through that. Next one, please. So this notion of Saku is what I'm calling the illumination. Saku, it's the illumination. And Saku is the understanding, illumination, the soul of being, the spirit that is the basis of all known and noble phenomena. Saku Jaya now I'm being my intellectual scientific self. I'm giving a new vocabulary to this, what we still call, but I think some should stop calling black psychology. I'm giving language to that, constructs to that, that this Saku Jaya is the process that allows for the illumination and the liberation of the spirit. That's what Ace and we were talking about. How do we rescue the African mind? How do we illuminate? What does the African mind look like? How are we able to see when someone walks up on me, I'm seeing an illuminated African, as opposed to what Frantz Fanon was talking about, a wretched of the earth. We're more wretched than we are illuminating. So we got to stop being wretched. Stop being wretched. Stop being wretched. You all do know in African languaging, you say things three times, that means it's important. You know, you say, oh, it's important. So yeah, I'm going to say to you, stop being wretched. Stop being wretched. Stop being wretched. Be dim. You dim people. That's who we are. We dim people. And even if you don't think you're dim people, I'd see you as dim people. I can see you dim. I can see you. So you may not know it yet, but that's who we are. We dim. All right? And so this idea of examining and explicating the meaning, nature, and function of being human, that's our task. It's not just psychology. That's our task as a good teacher, as a good lawyer, as a good, bless my heart, my husband got money, I ain't got to work, mama. It's all roles we play. All the roles we play in society have to take on this task of explicating the meaning, the nature, and the function of being human for African people by doing what? Conducting a deep, profound, and penetrating search. Ain't no lightweight stuff here. Ain't no Saturday night special. Ain't no I'm fixing to do it. No, it's about deep, deep thought that we have to engage in. Every time you look at me, I put this. So next one, please. Next one, please. And so we go back now. We go back to the beginning, at least one of our beginnings, in ancient Kemet. This is the first psychological text. The first psychological text. It's called the Psychostasis. Europeans stole psychostasis, psycho, and called it psychology. And now we run around saying, I got my master's in psychology. I got my PhD in psychology. And don't realize that back in the day, we had the psycho. And the psycho was on the walls of the great temples, showed a depiction of the weighing of the heart against the feather of my eye. Wade, come on up here, girl. You're gonna help me with this talk. This is she's ending my talk. I'm only kidding you. I want you to show me up. You can stay where you are. But what I want you to see is that this idea, when we start uncovering our stuff, stuff come out that we never thought about. The psychostasis says that the illumination, the judgment of the human spirit is symbolic. The psychotasia perceive the central and mutual interdependent role of intellect, emotion, conduct, functioning as a process of spirit being. Yeah. Our ancestors said this stuff is all interconnected. Mm-hmm. Western psychology said it's in competition. Mm-hmm. Or you got to get in touch with your emotions. Or you got to understand you're in conflict with your thoughts. Ours doesn't do that way. So this stuff is all interconnected, interdependent. next one, please. But I want, go back if I can. Go back if you can, quick. What I want to say is that doing our homework, each of those metal necklaces has a message. There's scripture there. Every single thing. Our ancestors said, I ain't wasting my time up in here. When I write in brick, it's something important. It's something important. So, but now your task is to go back and figure out how to read it and understand it. But that's okay. It can be done. We got some people now versed in the metal necklaces, so we can do that. But what I'm saying, in this moment, we have bringing me to the hall of judgment. Did you lead a good life? Yes. Did you lead a good life? And we can see some places where those ancient Kemetic verses get translated into the Talmud, get translated into the Christian Bible, get translated into all the major Western religions that we all know of now. It's just translations or residuals of that. But ours we were the first kids on the block. We were the first kids, and we did that. So we got to go back and pick that up and understand that. All those priests up top are saying something that is a recitation to what you need to do as a divine being made manifest. Next, please. And so this energetics, I like to play with physics. I like to energetics is important. I want to raise that up as a theme of knowing. Energetics pertains to energy or spirit that's transformative. Energy or spirit that's transformative. Sound as drumming and dance as motion are energy. Say it again. Sound as drumming and dance as motion are energy. And if you think about it, in a club, sudden beat coming, you just can't not stop. Or if you in church and the choir get to hit it real good, you all conservative, I got my degree, I'm a professional. Just choir start hitting it. hold that hand down. Before you know, you say, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. That's energetics. See, what we're doing is giving us the scientific foundation of how we be.
Yes.
How we be. We ain't got to apologize to nobody about how we be. All right? And so energetics has to do with drumming and dancing. So the drumming is vibrational sound that, watch this. Drumming is vibrational sound that aids in the transference between the material and the immaterial. So when you're doing drumming, and in fact, in our traditions, like in voodoo, like in Santeria, like in Candomblé, like in Ifa, every Orisha has a certain drum beat. Every Orisha has a certain drum beat, because if you know you're going to go to war, you're going to beat some Shango stuff.
Yes.
So Shango, lightning, fire. You see? And so we understood that. Because what? Because drumming is vibrational sound that transfers between material and immaterial. The book before I wrote this word was called The Island of Memes, Haiti's Unfinished Revolution. And in the Island of Memes, I tried to show that those brothers who were captive didn't just jump up and say, I'm tired of stuff, I'm going to go for broke. They studied the atmosphere and decided on what particular night was the atmospheric hemisphere right.
Yeah.
They decided that when they took that black pig and cut his belly open and they all bowed down to the pig and chanted a rhythmic sound, that the revolution was going to be successful. Now, they ain't had no guns. They had no ships out in the harbor. They had no cannons. But them Haitians took, Bonaparte and chased his behind back to France. Now, they couldn't do that by just being physical beings. I don't believe. They were tapping into, grabbing onto, understanding the energy fields in the universe. Energy fields in the universe. Our grandparents and great-grandparents did that when they went down in the backwater, in the Hush Harbor, put the pot down below the mother, and then shuffle in a counterclockwise circle. Shuffle in a counterclockwise circle. And they shuffled that way because they were doing what? Science. They understood that the earth, the planet, revolves in a counterclockwise circle.
Yes.
So if I'm going to be free, I got to align myself with a divinely governed universe. See, and so they did this. That's all them niggas just out there. Shuffle. Yeah, yeah. And so we even say, now, pick up your feet. No. Every now and then, you got to shuffle.
Yeah.
Every now and then, you got to shuffle. But don't shuffle any direction. Keep in mind, it's counterclockwise. Counterclockwise, because that's aligning yourself
with the universe.
With the universe. Then go into the board meeting. Then go into the promotion office. Before you go get your promotion, outside office. Outside the door, but the white folks talking about looking at your resume. You sit at the office, you shuffle in the counterclockwise. Then go in the room. See, I want you to see our science.
Yes.
This ain't mumbo jumbo backwards spooky stuff.
Yes.
This is our science.
Yes.
And if we can study it, we just open up the first page. We got an encyclopedia.
Yes.
We just open up the first page to start studying. And so then, now dance is the profound example of movement as transformative energy. We know this. Have a hard week at the job, we go down to the club, we start to have unfortunately, we have a couple of nips, and we start dancing. And when we dance, we come out feeling better. We go to a party. Even in some of our churches, we call it shouting and getting the Holy Ghost, but we're dancing.
Yes.
We're dancing, and we go out, we feel better. Because it does what? Dancing is a profound example of transformative energy. Take you from the low place to the high place. And so I want us to take our stuff back. Take our science back.
Yes.
Wiggle that right leg. Affirm the Africanness in you. Next, please. I want to give you this. Zola and N'Golo. Zola and N'Golo. Zola and N'Golo are two Bantu Congo words. Zola means love and energizing energy. Okay, let me have a flashback. When I was a child, old folks got sick. Other old folks come in the room with them, and they'd sit up with them, and they would rock.
Yes.
Sit up with the sick person and rock. I'm saying, now as a scientist, why are they rocking? They're rocking because they're sending out a particular vibratory rhythm.
Yes.
That's what Big Mama was doing. She was rocking. Then someone starts saying,
Yes.
What they doing? I'm a child. I said, oh, they're going to make him die. You do all that crazy stuff around him? No, they was bringing energy vibration and taking their divine energy made manifest and tapping into their second divine energy made manifest. And so Zola is a word I'm taking back. Zola is energizing energy. N'Golo refers to the energy of self-healing power. The African way says, she gets frustrated, she gets mad at me. She says, come on, Daddy, Granny. N'Golo is a self-energy potential. The African way says, we have in our DNA the ability to be well. Wow. We have in our energy ability. Now, I can show you what happens. If I cut your hand, your knowing and noble spirit knows how to take that cut,
that's right.
Put air on it, create a scab, seal it up, and drop the scab off. That's not no physiological act by itself. That's divine energy doing what it do. It is doing what? N'Golo. So now we have language for it. We can talk about how do I now do what? Activate your N'Golo by what? By Zola. Zola is the love that activates our self-healing potential. Hear me now. Love activates your self-healing potential. It's already in you. But I got to love you to make it activated. I can't just say you. In fact, old folks, I could keep flashback. Old folks wouldn't say, don't take me to no hospital. Not because there was segregation and rabidness. Old folks knew if you take me to the hospital, they're going to do a certain thing. They're going to take me to the hospital. They're going to put me in a ward. I get sicker, they're going to put me in a private room. Right. I get sicker, they're going to put me in a dual room. I get sicker, they're going to put me in a private room. They get sicker, they say, no one can come visit you. Yes. You're isolated. What are they doing? They're cutting you off from Zolo. They're cutting you off from the love that your folk can come. That's why old folks would smuggle some collard greens into the hospital. Smuggle some neck bones, if that was their dietary habit, into the hospital to give you some good food. Not because it was a certain kind of food, but because they made that food with love. They made that food with love. So I'm going to heal you, baby. You see what I'm saying? I want you all clapping because you're having flashbacks to your own families. Why? Because we're all kinfolk. We all had the same mama. We all had the same daddy. We didn't think we did. We had the same mom and daddy. And so what I'm doing now as a scientist is giving us language that allows us to talk about our stuff. That we now know that Zola, love, is the activator of N'Golo. And N'Golo is the self-healing potential. It is that Zola that would allow granddaddies to sit beside their baby and say, baby, you can do this. I can't read myself, but you can read, baby. You can read, baby. Come on, show me what the old folks taught us to read when they couldn't read themselves. Why? Because of Zolo. Zola, because the love activated my intellectual ability to self-heal. It's not just physiological healing, it is intellectual healing as well. So we got to go out here talking about Zola. In fact, I was suggesting to folk in the association that maybe we could try to get a salutation rather than say, what's up, brother? How's it hanging, girl? Let's start greeting each other with Zola up on we. If I say Zola up on we, I'm not only activating your self-potential, by my enunciation, I'm activating my self-potential, human potential. So maybe we can say, let's greet each other by saying, Zola up on we, Zola up on we, Zola up on we. I'm activating, by using we, not me, by using we are activating in that connection our self-healing potential. So rather say, what's up, blood? That was cool. Blood was all right because they said we got something streaming through us is the same. But I'm up to Annie now. Because language is important. Rather than saying, hey, my nigga. Rather than say that, say, what's up? Zola up on we. Zola up on we. If you say it enough, you start feeling a certain enunciation, vibratory in your throat. Zola up on we. And then get in the church like this. If this whole church will say, let me try. Let's say, Zola up on we.
Zola up on we.
Zola up on we.
Zola up on we.
Let's see. Choir, help me make them say it a little bit louder.
Zola up on we.
Zola up on we.
You hear the vibrating, echoing?
Yeah.
The echoing is a thought come back to you.
Yeah.
That's what echo does. Echo come back to you. So we can think about ways in which we can do what? Create rituals.
Yeah.
Rituals of salutation. Using our language. Using our understanding. Next one, please.
And so Zola, I went to the Zola, does all that good stuff. Next. Okay, my final reflection. Because I think my granddaughter told me, she's like this. My final reflection. Next, please. My final reflection is this. To become one with the divine, you must become the divine. Yes. To become one with the divine, you must become the divine in thought and in deed. This means that you must spiritualize your actions and your thoughts at all times. That's an ancient Egyptian thought. No matter what they did, they could not kill our ancestors' spirituality. And I would circle spiritness. I would put spiritness in this. No matter what they did, they could not kill our ancestors' spiritness. They tried from Cuba, they tried in Brazil, they tried in Nigeria, they tried in Haiti, they tried in New Orleans, they tried in the Geechee Islands. Our spiritness has survived everything. The propagandas, the stereotypes, the stigmas, and still we rise. We rise. It is my belief that we who call ourselves scholars and call ourselves intellectuals are simply portals. Information is coming through us. Ain't no genius up here. Ain't no intellectual up here. Ain't no, boy, he sure is smart. No, it's the intellectuals coming. And my job is to purify my portal. So it's like a tool, purify my portal so the information comes through clean and clear and powerfully. That's what we need to do. Next one, I think, is the last one. Asa, life as a husband, father, son, brother, nephew, grandfather. His grandkids called him Popeye. As well as a teacher, a jegna, a friend, a colleague, was characterized by the quest for joy and beauty that was so extraordinarily normal and ordinary that the quest was completely invisible. You didn't know Asa was after something. You didn't know Asa was chasing something. It was almost invisible, right? Asa, I had the special privilege of being with Asa Hilliard on his first trip to ancient Kemet, 1978, and I had the pleasure of being with him on his last trip to visit the Black Land Kemet. Asa and I went to a lot of conferences together, and we would sit together side by side, and when Asa spoke, he said something good, I would say, smoking, smoking. I said, fire! And when Asa stepped up, he would say, I would say, smoking. That was our little code, Fire, I mean, I approve, you did it right. But Asa, in Kemet, Asa was sitting beside me. He got up and went on the stage with the mayor of Aswan. He gave his speech. And then he walked off the stage. And when he was walking off the stage, I looked at him and said, man, Asa, he just come from Ghana. I said, Asa's tired, man. We all said, he's doing too much. He's tired. Asa walked off that stage and walked into eternity right before my eyes. That's a moment that still gets me emotional. Because he's my brother. He's like the two valves of our hearts beat together. Now, it says in Kemet, happy is he who comes to die in Thebes, Waset, the abode of the just, Ma'at, the place of silence. Evildoers come not here into the place of justice, Ma'at. Happiness to him who comes to die here. He will be a divine soul. Almost prophetically, I believe, Asa went home to Waset, to ancient Egypt, to die on August 13th, 2007. Asa Grand Hilliard, Nana Bafua Makwantia II, Pharaoh Per Ah, our great house of black light for educational excellence, has received his happiness. Last slide, please. Thank you. And it is to be African, to be family, to be awesome. Iya, her, Baba, me, and them children. And them children. Them children. That's our way. And I leave you with this one saying, go home and take a family portrait. Take a family portrait. Have it. Get all your kinfolk together. If you don't like Uncle Charlie, get him in the picture. Get in the picture. Get everybody. Because you don't realize how important imaging is. And I end every single professional presentation with this last slide. This baby that is in various arms, lap, is now getting ready to go to college. All them kids, all them children, some are crazy, some are good, but every time you look at them, you think, if you take that family portrait, you can study this. I can study my baby's pictures, the smiles, the thinking. What are they thinking? What have they come to earth to do? We come from heaven with a mission, with a purpose. our job as parents, as elders, is to guide their way and then get out the way.
Yes.
Thank you very much. That we created, we rescued. And Zion says that based upon the conversation you've heard, based upon the book you've read, based upon the experience you've had, what does it stimulate in your imagination and your memory? So if I may, rather than have Q&A, give me some imagination. Give me some memory. What did I say, or this thought, or this feeling of all those ancestral energies that are in this room right now cause you to imagine, good or bad?
Can you say something a little? Can you unpack imagination just for a minute?
Mm. Remember, I was doing so good, man. I think imagination has to do with imaging, and we have the power to make manifest what we image. And so that's why I see imagination as imaging. How do I image a new African? In fact, back in the Renaissance, our ancestors were saying we're going to create a new Negro, because they were even thinking about that. How do we imagine not being a slave? You see, that's so I see imagination as imaging, and what we have in the work we're doing now in terms of we're training a whole cohort of new in quote therapists. We're not calling them therapists, we'll call them Nganga. Nganga is a healer that has one foot in the visible world and one foot invisible. So we're training the next generation of, in quote, black psychologists as Nganga. And one of the tools we use with them is this idea of imagination and memory through Zaya. So we say every time we do a training for you, your job is to write up what do you imagine. Because we think that imagining is the voice coming through from the ancestors. Because I want you to imagine a thought you hadn't thought before. Don't imagine. I imagine when I was in Mississippi and cousin Bob did this. No, that's not the imagine I want. I want you to try to imagine a thought you hadn't thought before. That's hard to do.
Why is it so hard to do? And it's easier seemingly for children, but more complicated for us.
Children do it all the time. Children come to earth talking with their relatives that left them heaven. Having imaginary friends. You see, they have imaginary friends. See, so I'm saying we got to look at ourselves with African eyes. And so I think that I believe that the old, and the young, have a special bond.
Yes,
because
yes.
The old are getting ready to go back to heaven.
Yes, yes.
The young, just come from heaven. So they both got imaginations and memories about the invisible realm.
Yeah.
And so I think that this imagination is hard for us. Our Western training. I only know what you taught me as a teacher, but I can know the unknowable. I can see the unseeable. I can feel the unfeelable, but I gotta be encouraged to do that.
Yes.
And so what we're doing out in Texas is saying to our interns, we want you to take a charge at imagining a thought you hadn't thought before. You're gonna be working with, we deploy these interns into community-based organizations. Getting away from the academy and the community. So when you're in a community organization and brother comes in because the judge said go to the therapist or go to jail.
Yeah,
so he comes in there with an attitude. He comes with an attitude. But then I want you to imagine, help him to imagine what it would be like to be divine. Not a thug. I'm running shit on this block. No. I don't want you to be that. I want you to imagine something else. That's imagination.
That's powerful. Greg?
I know what I'm going to do with y'all.
I don't see it.
I'm going to hold this ancestral staff while you ask, while you all desire, while you all imagine, while you all memories.
Thank you so much for being here. I don't really know how to phrase this question. Okay, spirit. We know that spirit is light. We know that spirit is a connection to God. Are there other spirits that come like from darkness that may come to do harm or to bring harm to one?
I suspect there are, but I can't be definitive about that. I think that whatever Jesus has given to me, I'm focusing on the light. Because I do believe that when the light's turned on, the darkness knows what to do. Okay. So if there are demonic spirits, if I step in with a divine spirit, the demon knows what to do. So I'm sure there may be, or there may be just people doing bad stuff, doing wrong stuff that we coin as being evil. I honestly don't know if that evil works for me. What works for me is them. So I'm comfortable with them. And I also believe, at my almost 80 years old, that dim has worked. As I look back at my life, I see dim all over the place. I see us doing dim all over the place. I don't see no demonic stuff. I know I've heard about it, but I don't see no demonic stuff. I see Big Mama getting some garlic and put it in the water and putting the cup under her bed. What was that about? Because that energy vibration of that garlic mixed with water does something. So as a chemist, maybe I want to learn that, figure what that is. You see? That's what I decided. So, sister, I believe that there may be, but I don't want you all to leave with saying Dr. Noble signed off on the demons. I ain't signing off on the demons. I'm signing off on them.
Signing off on them. Mm-hmm. Somebody imagine.
That is a real good question, because we got to deal with that. That's in our community. Yeah. The folk in our community walking around with that. That's in my community. And folk even say that people who are suffering some kind of mental illness are being possessed by demons. I don't know. The Catholic Church have priests walking around throwing water on you, talking about out demon, out you demon. Maybe so, but I don't know. I'd rather say out you demon, I want to say in you demon. In you demon.
Yes, sir.
Zaya, what do you imagine? What stimulates your imagination, your memory? And it's okay if you don't, because this is a new exercise.
It is.
This is a new exercise. We're not used to doing this. We are used to Q&A. Mm-hmm. And in fact, our Q&A works like you don't even ask a question, you can make a statement. Yes.
Amen.
Is there a question in there? So we're used to that. Our question, that's what Francis Nunn talked about, is being made wretched.
Yeah.
We've been made wretched, so we got to shake off that wretchedness. And then now, maybe after this woman's over, you all can have practice that. Practice that imagining the unimaginable.
Yeah.
And don't do it in front of a Western-trained psychologist, because he might say you're schizophrenic. He might say you're paranoid. So be careful, but I want you to feel. We have safe places. This is a safe place.
Safe space.
Do it there. Try it out. It's like anything. It's like any ability. You got to practice at it. Practice being African. Practice being dim. Imagination right there. Come on, sister.
I first thank you for being present here and being a well-spoken black psychologist, which is the most sought-after psychologist now. They're looking for African Americans because we need more of them. Mm. And you, the first question you said was, what are you walking away with? And for me, it resonated with reading each other as a text and seeing into each other and how are we able to critically think about each other, what we see fits up on the surface. But then as you take your clues, when we read regular, as we paper text,
yes,
how do we see what's not said? How do we see the invisible? How do we help to build each other, not just surface or the visible, but how do we see within each other to build the unseen parts?
Those are absolutely important questions and hard questions, because I think that we are sacred text, or we don't know how to read the Bible. Mm. We have sacred texts. We don't know how to read the Bible. But we are working at it. We're working at it. We have some hints. Some of the hints is that energetics I put up on the board. Energetics. Look how we move.
Yeah.
Look how we move. Some of the sounds. You know, we do know in the Western, we now know, depending upon what sound a baby hears in its mother's womb, accelerates or retards its growth. That's defined energetics. So we need to put all these young people together and say, your sign, like old folks would say, now you're going to go off into college. Don't come back here and be a fool. You're going off to college. Don't come back here and be a fool. Go to college and get something that we can use.
That we can use.
That we can use. So maybe we need to give our young people assignments. You interested in chemistry? Good. But I want you to understand, what does this melanin capacity really do for us? It don't just make us have different color complexions. There's something called epidermal melanin that has to do with our third eye and our brain anatomy. Go study that and bring it back home. You in IT? Go study this AI stuff. Understand, how is it they're able to make a voice in a holograph look just like me? And I could be up here teaching you stuff saying, y'all go love white folk. And you said, Dr. Nobles, I heard him say it myself. He said, go, no, see, they can do that kind of crazy stuff. But we got to understand everything there is to know. Let me say it again. We have to understand everything there is to know, and we can't understand everything we is to know if we don't first know ourselves. Because knowing ourselves allows us to understand the wheat from the chaff. Understand what's wrong, what's good.
Dr. Nobles,
to the lines, yes.
I'd like to take a stab at it myself.
Please.
So this is the year of the child. And when you were speaking, you mentioned the seniors, our seniors, and our children. It led me to kind of envision and image a church that can curate a space.
Come on.
Where seniors and children
relate
to each other.
Yeah.
And there's intergenerational transmission of information that brings healing and medicine to the community.
Yes.
That informs our children, but also brings about another or a higher vibration, if you will, of community.
Yes. That is absolutely right. The only proviso would be all seniors aren't elders. Some folk are just old. And so I would want to put my children in the presence of an elder, not in the presence of old folk. And even with the presence of elders, we need to have some learning. See, I'm still learning. So I want to be able. I want to be committed to my transformation and my transcendence as an elder, then put me in front of some children.
Yeah.
If I just think I'm an old folk and I know stuff, I'm going to teach you that old Bammy stuff that I learned when I was a kid.
Yeah.
That ain't going to work for us.
Yeah.
So I would just tweak that a little bit and say, yes, we want to put children with elders. An elder is a sacred salutation.
Yes.
All old people ain't elders. Yeah. They're just old. Yeah. And they're going to work on it.
Say that one more time. Elders.
Y'all be quiet and listen.
Oh, I can hold it.
There, many children are elders.
Yeah. Children come here with something. That's important to recognize. But I think that's a good strategy, Pastor, is to figure out how we get that intergenerational conversation. But the intergenerational conversation has to be medunecha, divine speech.
Okay.
Not tef-tef. Tef-tef is idle chatter. You're just talking to be talking. So we'll work on that. How do we get a conversation of medunecha, divine speech? And that divine speech may come out of the mouths of a baby. And we do it all the time. Sometimes your baby said, Mama, that man ain't good for you. She done flipped the script. She's your mama.
Yeah.
You know? And so that's okay to recognize that. Yeah. And say, oh, you shut up. I'm the mama here. at this moment, you're acting like a child.
No. Whoa.
So and then we get all pushed out of pockets, you see? So we got to really think about how do we what?
Dr. Noble, I need you to hold that mic a little steadier because you're dropping some jewels right now. You are saying we need to hear this.
I can't do James Brown. I'm sorry. I try. But sometimes it may just be that I'm wishing away some stuff. I don't know what it is, but I'll try. But you see, I think that's what I wanted to say is that we need to have an intergenerational conversation that is guided.
Okay.
That is guided. And there are some knowing ones that you may want to put in charge of that intergenerational conversation and separate the old from the elders. Because again, I believe elders are a sacred salutation.
Elders.
When I say Elder Jones, it ain't because the church said he's our elder. It's because I see something in him. I see something in Elder Jones that say I bow down to his grace. Grace. Thus, we take all these things and think about it and unpack it. What does it mean? What does it mean to be in grace? Let's work on that for a moment. We do all the time in our churches. We do all the time about grace and precious love. What's precious? What does precious mean? That's a salutation. See, so I want us to think about everything. We use in our training, languaging, not language. Languaging. Because languaging has the power to be made manifest. So when I say UMF,
I'm going to take her job. Go ahead. No.
Let's fire her. She said they're being all cute. Give me science and stuff. But ain't doing her job. Thank you. So what I'm trying to say is that we need to look at languaging. Because languaging connotes the power to make manifest. I call it forth. That's languaging. Language is vocabulary.
Okay.
You see? So I want to do languaging. I want to say, what words do I use in my program? That's why in part of Black psychology that I'm working with, I'm changing all the language. We have, for example, give one example. We used to have people called clients, patients, court-appointed, whatever. We've changed that name to Bwana Mboti. Bwana Mboti. You know what Bwana Mboti means? It means the child of my ancestors. So if I'm a clinician and you've been sent to the court with me, if I see you my client, this is separation. I can say I don't care about you. But if you're my kinfolk, you're a child of my ancestors, that's a different vibratory relationship I'm establishing with the client-patient population, you see? And not only are you Bwana Mboti, but I'm a Bwana Mboti. So at some point, you, in quote, the patient, may be healing me, the doctor. You see, so we got to change all the paradigms.
Right.
Change all the paradigms. And I think one way of changing the paradigm is through languaging, study the language. And I think that the Bantu Congo, even though there's a whole big argument about what African language should we use, and people say Kiswahili, and people say Twi in Nigeria. No, I think that I'm comfortable when I look at the map of Africa. 3/4 of Africa are Bantu. 3/4, that's a big continent.
Right.
3/4 of that continent are Bantu people, but they Bantu Zulu, they Bantu Ashanti, they Bantu. Gotcha. See, so Bantu is like the last name. I'm a Texas Bantu. Y'all New York Bantu. You see, and so I can say some of them Texas folk that I don't quite understand, but if we go to the Bantu side, I start seeing stuff I can recognize. See, that's what I want to figure out how do we. I want to really figure out how do we do African? How do we be African? How do I walk in the world as a divine being with an African face? And that's a big job. That's a big job. Is that easy? We're going to leave out here now? I got it now. I saw you're born in Boti. I got it now. Nganga. Don't be using no language because you're going to roll off your lips the wrong way. Study. When you go through a traditional initiations, the first thing that the Babalawo or the Ifa priests say is that you have to study. They say you have to do the work. You can't just say, I'm going to go to Nigeria and pay $4,000, $5,000, I'm coming back, I'm a Babalawo. No, you are ignorant. You got to do the work. Do the work. And whatever it is that your trade is, whatever your craft is, do the work. unpack, unwrap. Know when you are walking on only on the left leg. Only on the left leg. Don't realize that you're only on the left leg. Don't even know that you got a right leg. Yeah? Work on that. That's all I really want to really please here is that we got to do the paradigm shift. Take back our stuff. And you can't take back our stuff if you don't rescue it. Because Western domination of the world was the lie about African knowledge, the lie about African science, and made us grow up thinking we had nothing. We had nothing. That's the biggest lie, the biggest crime they've ever done. So our job is to break into the vault, steal our stuff back. Break into the vault of knowledge and steal our stuff back.
Dr. Noble, you shared with me in the office that there was actually even an apology offered by the Western, by the West.
Yes, yes. I use this is called the APA. Some of you know the APA, the American Psychological Association. That's the biggest, most powerful organization of psychologists in the world. Everywhere you go, does someone get an APA certification? All your programs in this country, psychological, had to be certified by APA to even offer a psychological degree. APA is powerful. About 50 years ago, we started Black Psychologists. We were at an APA convention, and we challenged. We had an argument with APA. You need to acknowledge that you're not doing anything that's with the harm that's happening to Black people. They pulled us off, and so we literally we got together about 30 Black folk who were trying to be psychologists, who were psychologists but were afraid, who were students. Got together in a room. And we said, "Well, we want to petition APA." That's how we wanted to petition. Maybe we have a march. So that's what I meant. We were petition APA. It was the students. I've been one of them. Not taking no special credit. But it was the students said, no, we don't need to petition APA. We should break away from APA and start our own association of Black psychologists. Oh, and we argued. I had a new wife, a new baby, and it's now 2 a.m. in the morning. And I only went to this convention because my professor, white professor, said, I'll give you extra credit if you go down to the APA convention and be a gopher. Gopher? Gopher? I need extra credit. It turns out gopher means you go for this, you go for that. Whatever the white folks want, you go get it. So I said, okay, here's what I'm going to do. As soon as my professor sees me in the lobby, I'm heading out the side door and going to my wife. Because I ain't going to play this gopher game. And so as I was walking out the door, there were like 4 or 5 Black psychologists. That was more Black psychologists I've ever seen. In all my college career, I think I saw 2 Black psychologists. Mm. There were like 10 of them out there. And they're outside the bar. So we have 2 things here. Yeah. Brothers outside the bar.
Yeah.
Brothers cussing. Yeah. They're saying, these MFs, I'm tired of this SHIT. I'm tired of these white folks. So they're speaking my language.
Yeah.
So I slid up close to these psychologists. And they were talking about, we're tired of APA doing what they're doing. Have all these tests about nurture and nature, that you know, we nurture people and then nature people are IQ tests and we're dumb and this one. We're tired of all this stuff. So they said, let's go figure this out. So they went into one person's room and we start talking. And you know how Black folks do. We start talking, somebody said I got some wine, someone said I got some fried chicken. And we were just talking, debating. And so we finally agreed that we're gonna start an association of Black psychologists, independent of APA, which we did. But the very next day, we woke up and said, we got an association of Black psychologists, but we don't have a Black psychology. What we gonna do? And we literally went to work. We went to work doing researching and writing and publishing and creating the compendium of information that was under the rubric of Black psychology. And over that evolution, we went from being Black psychologists who were Negroes, being Afro psychologist, being African psychologist, being Pan African psychologist, to my realm being Sakushetis, the illuminators. Right? But in that process, about a year ago, APA, this most powerful white organization of psychologists, declared and made public, written to public, an apology for being complicit. I use this is them being complicit. You go to court and say, you complicit, mean you're a part of a crime.
Yeah.
That's what it says. So being complicit doesn't mean you're part of the crime. And they wrote in their own monograph that they were complicit in doing harm with their theories and practices, doing harm with Black people and other people of color. And so we said, that's it, They don't deserve no clap. Let me just say that. They don't deserve no clap. So, A, beside Black Psychologist, said, your apology is unacceptable. We threw it back in your face. Because if you don't restore what you have made harmful, you ain't did nothing. You know? And so we're engaging right today. We're engaging in this great debate. And interesting enough, these people, this may be demonic. These people are so strange. Immediately over the last couple of minutes, they elected Black women to be the president of APA. What does that mean? I get to fight a sister.
Yes.
Wow. And these sisters are so happy, which we think I ain't taking it from. I'm the president of the most powerful association in the world.
They want you to use the mic, though.
We in church, but the choir's not here right now. So don't y'all be singing together. You all are intimidating me. or like the white woman say, you make me feel so uncomfortable. I'm sorry. But what I'm saying is that's devious. Because here's the Black Psychologists Association, who now has influenced the world. ABSI has went to South Africa and started an association of South African Black Psychologists modeled after what we do. They went to Cuba, went into Haiti, went into Brazil, went to Ghana. So we're starting a whole global pan-African movement about psychologists, and I'm hoping that my part is to change the language. Languaging. We don't need to be Black psychologists, because that makes Black the adjective that modifies psychology. We ain't no modification of this stuff. We stand on our own ground. That's why I titled my book, The Science of Being. I'm saying we should move from Black psychology to the science of being, and then move forward, because it's an unfinished song. But the battle with the APA is going on. It took them 50 years. Think about all the harm they've done. And we've been documenting that, you know, they should have these insane asylums for colored people. Literally. And all the colored people who are acting up were deemed insane and put in insane asylums, which were prisons. They do that today. In our prisons today, our young men and women are being treated as criminal, but experimented on as patients. You see? So we got to fight this stuff. This is serious business. We got to figure out how to do that, and we can only do that by making ourselves right. Only do this because a lot of places, the warden is a brother or a sister. The prison guard is a brother or sister. The armed guard on the balcony, my brother's working in San Quentin, who has a gun, who's going to shoot you if you walk across the line, is a brother. See, so we got to work on ourselves, because again, I say to you, when the light shines on, the dark knows what to do. You got to what? Be African. Be family. Be awesome. You got to be awesome. No low life, no second class, no I'm thinking about it, I'm fixing to do it, I might do it, I can't do it. No. Be African.
Yes!
Be African. Be African. And in being African, you cannot but be awesome. So APA is a long, long battle we're fighting, because they've done more harm to our people than we can ever imagine. All the school psychologists who deem a child as being medically retarded, uneducable, is because of an APA theory or something like that. All our children, lives disrupted, the potential cut in half because some psychologist said this child can't learn, or this child needs Ritalin, needs some drugs to calm him down. Don't calm the child down. Speed the teacher up. Make the teacher go. Okay, I don't want to go any further. Pastor.
Is that it? Are we good? All right, one more time. Let's thank God and our ancestors for Dr. Wade Noble. Powerful. And I can't think of a better lecture or segment to end this transformational week. You brought it all together, God. Thank you so much. I am told, although it was not planned, I am told, and I hope I got this right, that there's actually lunch across the street. Where's Elder Chamble? I understand that there's some lunch I just want to know what's on the menu today. All right, they're still putting it together. And as the custom has been all week, the lunch is free. The lunch is free. All right, so I'm going to offer prayer over the blessing of the food. There is no afternoon session. However, there's one more opportunity to be present for the suite, and that's 7 o'clock tonight. And our guest preacher is Dr. Starsky Wilson from the Children's Defense Fund. You don't want to miss Dr. Wilson. It's going to bless your life. Amen? Let's pray together. Oh, by the way, books. They're out. Okay, so we're gonna ask Dr. to go out and sign the books if he's willing to do so. All right, so you can purchase books today at the end of this session. Lord, we thank you for this moment. We thank you for the illumination and the reclamation of African minds. Thank you for the courage. Thank you for the hopefulness that has come forth in this moment. Would you bless Dr. Wade Nobles? Bless Mama Vera. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you for the realization that not all old folks are elders. Somehow you gave us the capacity to imagine again. And then you gave us the wisdom to start training seniors to become elders. So God, keep on doing your perfect work. We thank you for the ancestors who are guiding us in this moment. We thank you for food. We thank you for fellowship. And thank you for this week of transformation. We give you thanks, praise, glory, and honor. In your name we pray and trust. Amen and amen. God bless you. Go on out and buy your book.